bit unusual for RTZ to play AM.
Sorry, I want to explain myself. I would like to say
I have the steps to break it up.
We've seen Keeper of the Light and AM being some typical pickup off Secret more than once.
Okay.
Right, but it's not always like their go-to. It's not necessarily the safest. But also the Lions guys were mentioning, I mean, Keeper of the Light, if it's open, they usually want to take it in that game one. So the foundation was there for a typical draft for Team Secret, but now we are already in the draft for game number two, so let's see how IG adapts to Secret, and if Secret are just going to kind of throw them off their game once again.
That was one of my big questions, though, going into game one. You know, Secret had actually been called very conservative. And if you listen to some of PPD's draft analysis following DAC, Secret were very predictable in terms of their drafts in that tournament. And it's really only been recently, since they got that first win and have loosened up a little bit, that they've become one of the more versatile teams in Pro Dota. And I really wondered, going into these just huge games today, which drafting style we'd see, whether or not they'd go back to sort of very cookie-cutter drafts, or whether they'd maintain that flexibility that we've seen from them over the last couple months.
I feel like, though, if you compare their previous draft with this one, one thing that stands out to me is that the first game seems to be a solid, like, a draft that they've played before. They just want to show that, you know, they don't want to be behind. That's, like, the number one thing. They don't want to, you know, like, kind of come into the series and going into a 0-1.
Right.
It's really important to them, so they go with a very standard, I mean, I would say standard draft, or at least with an opening we've seen before, and then you can expect crazy stuff in game two.
Right, so something that they've played before, they know they've won with, so they have that confidence in game one, and then now that they have a win, they have even more confidence, regardless of pace. But look at that, Lesh and Tusk getting through for Secret. They've got to feel pretty good about that.
Are we going to see a respective techies ban?
I mean, maybe, because we talked about this yesterday, Ben. I mean, do you ban out the Tusk, because that also enables that, or do you ban out the techies, or do you just not worry about it? What do you think, if you're IG, are you a little bit afraid now?
I think, firstly, they need a solution for the Leshrac. I think it's already too far ahead to think about, you know, potential Tusk partners. Leshrac, we've seen banned out most of the time in the tournament. We saw a pretty good one by Fada, but we haven't seen one, like, absolutely dominating. Like, let's say, Sumail's Storm Spirit. The Leshrac, I think, Secret's very, very happy to get.
Right. No, I mean, I think we talked about this a little bit last night, that while, I mean, the techies was obviously so much fun to watch, it was a little bit of a smokescreen. That game was essentially decided by S4 getting mid on a Storm Spirit against the Dragonite.
Yeah.
And I really worry, you know, you spend a little bit too much time thinking about the techies niche pick, and you miss the fact that Leshrac and Tusk is a very, very good open right there. I like the Rubrik response, though, from IG.
Yeah, all right. So trying to cover things up a little bit, and then getting rid of the Caudle there, the Keeper of the Light from IG. They didn't like how to deal with it in game one, and of course, kind of something that Secret always reverts back to if they can. So taking that out of the draft here.
And the crazy thing about techies is it can mind game you inside the game, but also outside of the game.
Yes,
exactly.
Like, you don't want to, like, crap, do we need to ban the techies? And, I mean, bans are just so valuable, and the draft overall is so important that you can't, you know, think like, oh God, they're going to pick techies. We're going to lose.
To me, that really is the difference between these just world-class master drafters like PPD, like S4, like FNG, that you're really second-guessing yourself during the draft. You're not just thinking about, okay, how do our heroes match up with their heroes? You're thinking about all the things that they could pick. And when you have this many weapons on a team, it really just gets in your head.
I do think right now, in terms of mid matchups, Secret has the upper hand.
Oh, for
if
sure.
It's going to be a Leshrac against Queen of Pain middle, which I think would be likely that we're going to see that. And banning out that Broodmother, I feel like we could maybe see some 2-1-2 where you want to weaken that. You want to ban out the Broodmother so you can open up for a 2-1-2 scenario. With a tri-lane, it's fine to play against a Broodmother.
Right.
But if you want to have an opening to consider a 2-1-2 scenario, it's really tough if you leave out Brood.
The fact that they ban out the Broodmother tells me that they're not going for the Bloodseeker, because they feel like he's really good against it in the early laning stages,
right,
where you can really negate the Broodmother. And then, more importantly for you guys that really wants the techies pick, Broodmother is, of course, one very good hero up against it, sending those Broodlings around to trigger the mines.
Very true.
Do you feel like you get a little bit of that mid advantage back by picking your Nurse Shaker alongside your Queen of Pain to bother that Leshrac early on?
I think Rubik can do a decent job at helping out middle.
Okay.
With smoke gangs, it can be quite efficient against a Leshrac, but you also have Secret picking the Leshrac on the Radiant side. He's a lot more vulnerable on the Dire side. That's against right. the Queen of Pain.
I can't help but notice that Artisi keeps on sitting down there chuckling. He's in front of the camera.
It's our tour, man.
He keeps laughing a little bit. I don't know if they have something clowny up their sleeve.
Or if they're just listening to us.
they shouldn't be able to be listening on us. But, of course, Alliance talking about how they saw yesterday. I mean, Artiz is just kind of like sitting there smiling. They're like, oh, we figured they might actually pick up that Bloodseeker because he's just like, hey, I want to play this hero. Today's just the day. I have that feel. Let's go with it. So I think maybe we'll wait and find out if that's how it's going to go down as Razor gets locked in. For Secret. Yeah.
And this is Razor is really, you may see an S4 Razor, of course, that's always a possibility, but Razor is just one of those heroes that if you look at the farm that Arteezy is able to accumulate on this hero, it's just worlds beyond anybody else. I mean, the stats aren't even close.
I mean, it's not set in stone yet, but I think they prefer having Arto on Leshrac as a mid hero. Hmm. If they would tend to run that way.
He's all definitely right. The hero that I feel benefits a little bit more from farm. I actually really like this Lina combination, and from IG, I feel like IG is a bit more likely than most other teams to fall back to that Lina in the support position.
This is actually what they did yesterday in the win against the Leshrac.
Yep.
Picking up that Lina.
That's very true.
And versus the Razor.
Yeah, that was burning Lina, though, right?
It's actually very. I do think it's a very solid pickup here. Mm-hmm.
Just you like the one or the four Lina?
I like the position two Lina as the mid laner.
Yeah, but yesterday we played it as a one.
Yeah, yesterday it was burning.
All right, I would say it stands really good here against the Razor in the mid as well as the Leshrac. You have a solid hero that used to be picked a lot, but then it kind of lost its drive. Pretty much only with a Ganym's nerf on the
Yule's nerf, Glimmer Cape.
True.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, sword.
I mean, IG definitely had success with that yesterday. We'll see if it's a little bit of a different play here, depending on where that Lina goes in terms of position. But I think for now we can expect maybe the same idea as yesterday with IG, given the similar drafts so far on both sides.
I think it's just really important that they don't let the Leshrac get out of control. Firstly, like, don't make it a straight one-on-one in mid if it's Queen of Pain versus Leshrac. Like, have some support, you know, have some support, maybe even like TP in, fill up the bottle, fairy over salve, control runes. I think it's really important just the Leshrac doesn't get like haste runes, regen runes, and just dominate two or three lanes at once. And I think Secret can like completely win the game just based off a Leshrac getting out of control.
All right. Oh, and Secret banning out that SC in game one, but picking up for themselves here. Going for the little combo themselves.
It looks like there could be a support duo now. Having Leshrac and Shadow Demon.
I was wondering that when we were talking just now that we seem all justifiably so to be assuming that it's going to be the Leshrac in that core position, and I certainly think the stats say that that's much more successful.
They don't play that style though. Like they don't play like.
They don't play the heavy roaming.
Not dual heavy roam.
Yeah.
It's usually one greedier one and then one.
It doesn't even have to be a roaming though. If you just think about it, SD
can set up for the middle.
Yeah, he can just do it on his own and just move around.
Very that's true.
Or you trialing that around the tusk.
Trialing could potentially work, but
they could be setting up defensively against IG because IG hasn't been shy to do the trialing aggressive trialing.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, Secret, of course. This has been their trend, and maybe the recipe for success is that they still leave all their options open. They always try to cover all their bases. And Nana Siren being banned out pretty much all day today after some success yesterday from various players, and now coming out.
So we've seen EG really resurrect the support Naga recently, and just you've seen them display in some recent games. The Dota Pit finals against Secret are a great example, just how heavily Naga Siren can punish BKBs. And you've got probably both cores on Secret right now, maybe all three, are going to be looking to get that BKB up. The Naga Siren really effective at isolating those targets. I really do think this is going to be a burning farming Naga, and man, that would be such a treat. One of the best farmers in the history of the game on one of the best farming heroes. I know, these games can get a little slower paced, but to me, that's what I want to see.
All right, and the last ban's coming out. What do these tell us about IG and Secret rounding out their lineup?
I think it's safe to say that there's no techies pickup in this game.
I do wonder.
It's not looking like it.
No.
If I remember correctly, yesterday, Luo ran a short lane Queen of Pain.
Mm-hmm.
So you could even consider some kind of contestment with these three heroes on the side of IG.
I think it's a support Naga, though.
You do?
Yeah, I think the Leshrac deals with a core Naga actually pretty easily. Firstly, they have a few spells that can kill people through sleep. The Pulse Nova, you can snowball on someone, Razor's Ult, and Shadow Demon Poison can still, you know, kill people, and Demonic Purge. So, that's... When you're playing Naga Sunner, you want to feel completely safe whenever right. you farm. You can just sleep TP out every single time, and a lot of times it's just not possible. You get caught up by SD, you're just dead. Edict will still go off as well. I mean, there's just so many things. And it's nice to counter-initiate the Tusk Snowball. I'm not exactly sure why they picked up the Naga Sunner. You did mention it's a great BKB counter, but I think it's far too risky, and I think Secret's early game is way too good to go in for a core Naga.
I do think it's a less recommend to be on the middle lane with the Shadow Demon just setting it up for.
Okay. Shadow Demon doing its own work around the map with the Lesh sitting makes in mid sense. And the Bounty Hunter coming out for Secret.
Should be Kuroki Bounty Hunter.
Yeah, yes. This is really nasty. And they're gonna be looking to get a lot of early kills with that Tusk, and I mean, provided that bounty gets to 6 at any reasonable time, they can just snowball in the mid game. I agree now. I think the Bounty Hunter pick pushes me more toward a support Naga, because I think that the core Naga is not going to have time to get Radiance online.
I don't really know how IG is going to handle the Razor, though. They don't really have a good matchup. All those heroes have targeted spells versus unstable.
Very true, and the Tidehunter being the last pick here for IG. So, looks like Secret maybe still getting kind of the game they want here. In game number 2, they may very well go 2-0 to face EG in the finals, but we'll have to find out. Nothing's decided yet until we jump into the game with the casters over on the desk.
That's right. In number 2, Invictus Gaming up against Secret. I'm Toby One here with Sindarin to bring us our last, potentially, game of the semi-final. Invictus Gaming, man, you look at the draft.
Welcome to the TI2 time machine.
it really does.
What I'm just thinking here when
all we're missing is a Morphling from their lineup, and it will feel really, really comfortable.
Good old Naga Tidehunter combination, and I think it's going to be a core Naga. I haven't really seen who pick what. It's actually impossible that it's anything else now, unless they swap around. It's got to be burning on it this game.
Melanie was right with these points, though. Yes, like the Naga absolutely. Siren is very heavily countered by the way Team Secret play, but you also know the effect that the burning Naga Siren can have. Like, he can farm very, very quickly, but as the boys on the panel were saying, it's all about the timing. How long is it going to take before burning is effective for IG?
I think this time around, IG will... I don't think they'll make the early mistakes they did in the laning stage of the last game, and if they don't do that, they're in for a much better, let's say, minute 10 to 15, which is where Secret in the last game managed to get Arteezy his good farm that set up for the Battle Fury and ultimately allowed him to snowball very much. This time around, I think IG have... they're feeling more comfortable with their draft. This is a very IG-esque draft. And if they get the lanes they're looking for, and if they manage to especially shut down Kuroki on the Bounty Hunter, he will be very weak in the mid portion of the game against this kind of team fight.
Puppy hanging in the trees right next to IG, and they ping out and say he's there. Chuan coming close towards the tower. We'll take one hit from the tower. But Secret don't really have any major desire to fight up against him. Maybe they could isolate one with the shards. But there's no risk they really have to take. You're not going to battle into a Tidehunter. You could have severe problems going up against both the Riptide as well as Scream, not to mention the stuns and the control of telekinesis. So they'll just give up the bottom rune. That means Arteezy can take the top rune. Ferrari's going to take the bottom. And everything would just slowly move its way into the lanes.
Yeah, this mid matchup is definitely one to watch. It's one of the matchups that that Queen of Pain can lose. generally, Ferrari doesn't lose on this here in the mid lane, but playing up against the Leshrac, it is definitely possible, as looks like they will be moving S4 to the off lane on Razor. Been a while since I've seen him playing that lane. He is, of course, not playing flat one-on-one. There will be a Bounty Hunter of Kuro helping him out. And just looking at this matchup in general, just Tide versus Razor is unwinnable for Tide. He gets completely destroyed, and you throw a Bounty Hunter with an Orb of Venom in the mix, Luo is going to have a horrible laning stage. But what's the trade-off? IG will be helping out Ferrari a bit in the mid lane with Tron, as it looks, for starters, and then they play the Naga Lina bottom lane, which I feel like that's a pretty even lane, honestly.
It kind of does feel that way. At the same time, if you could isolate like faith from burning, you could find yourself with a kill potential at least. In this middle lane, I'm wondering just how much work Chuan can do, because Kuro is going to stalk him to the ends of the earth. He's already got this orb of venom harassing Chuan down. He's even forced to use a telekinesis to buy himself some space. While up on top lane, S4 just has to go for Static Link. Normally meant to have a great time. Wait, okay, there's those shards and faith being the one to be harassed. But normally you're able to come in with Tidehunter, you anchor smash down, you always have the damage advantage, but how do you do this up against a hero like a Razor who can just static link you, and you can't run away, you're Tidehunter, you take a while to walk anywhere.
Mid lane, Kuro's gonna go for Ferrari, but they already whiffed the stun from Arteezy. If that one lands, that could be the first shot.
Shards on bottom though, and into a snowball, face in trouble. Zai's right behind him. First blood goes to Zai. Burning wants revenge. He's got 4-1 charges available, but it won't be enough to find mana, and he cannot come that deep underneath the tier 1 tower.
And this lane is a very, very big deal. The Tusk will be getting level 3 in a moment.
He's already got bottle. We're not even 2 minutes in, he's managed to buy a bottle.
And their kill potential is going to ramp up very quickly in this lane. Faith will have a harder and harder time being down here together with Burning. And if they don't get good farm in the Naga from the start, they're not going to have a very good mid-late game. So I think IG might be considering at this point whether it's worth it for Chuan to be up here. I guess they feel forced so that Luo doesn't get completely run over in his lane. At least with Chuan up here pulling, forces Kuroki to focus a little bit on him.
Watch him too.
And yep, he's got plans.
It is that time. The little podgling is coming out. And if Kuro can take this out, then this middle lane is just fully crippled. And it is waiting. It is waiting very patiently. On the top of the hill. Good boy. Sit, boo-boo, sit. Bottom lane, though, burning. Snowball's going to come after him. Puppy's still right behind it with the poison, but not enough damage on him yet. So here comes Chuan. Like, he is now basically the magical courier for Invictus Gaming.
They're actually waiting. It's been standing there for like 30, 40 seconds. They're waiting till 3 minutes.
Arteezy's done a full bottle charge. They wait for the 3 minute mark. Arteezy's done a full bottle charge, sends it back already, and he's basically a full bottle time in front of him. Bottom lane, disruption again, gonna go to work. And it's keeping Faith out of this lane. It's making sure there's no combo. Oh, Kuro, he's actually here again, waiting for it. Puppy dog, come to his arms. Does he have enough damage? He can reach it, but three HP. That's all he had.
Man, if that Orb of Venom dealt damage to the courier, it would have actually died. But it doesn't. Only slows it down, but doesn't finish it off entirely. And that's actually a pretty big deal. Kuro committed so much time into this. Sure, Luo is still losing the top lane, but not as much as he could be. He's actually 14 CS against the 21 of the S4 Razor, which I think is a pretty solid performance from Luo in this game after his offlane last game did not work out too well with his Bristle versus Tusk. Oh, he was even safe lane.
Do you have confidence? There's two poisons over on Chuan at the moment. So follow-up stun, Light Strike Ray will control Zai for the moment. He's got 3-1 chances, they're giving up for shards, and he can throw it out on top of Ferrari. Can he get the last hit? The answer is no. Ferrari will run inside the pit. He's actually buying up all of his items so he can deny himself to Roshan, and that will in fact happen. So it shows us 2-for-1, but it's in fact a straight trade-up.
He lost 7 gold.
Massive.
Just letting you know.
This is the reason why we cast together, Sin. Do you notice the details?
Yeah, absolutely. I was wondering if you could make that sound really exciting.
No.
I feel like I didn't manage that.
It could have been epic, it could have been amazing. But it was actually crap. All right.
Thank you, Tom.
Got your back, bro.
So, what are we looking at for the lane so far? Secret, they have the CS advantage currently with both Razor and Lishrec out farming the counterparts, but then at the same time, Zai, only 13 CS on the Tusk to the, I guess, 18 is the
top player. So,
yeah, Luo is in a lot of trouble. I think he's actually going to live.
For now, but they also just brought Puppy to the top lane, so. Like, you're salving up, but you've only got boots and 2 tangos. There's no way, like, even with 2 points up in Kraken Shell, to hold off with the damage of Razor. He's got phase boots already available, and now in comes Puppy. Starts with a catcher, wants to follow up with some poison. Now in comes your Janata attack, or should from Kuro, if he doesn't even have it, he's only level 1. But the plasma field into Luo. They need more damage, but they just don't have it. Where was that Janata? Faith? He might be hoping to go for a stray Light Strike Array, while Arteezy, very deep behind the T1 tower in mid, lets the Lightning go with the Pulse Nova. Chuan has to back up. Lightning's back off cooldown, and Ferrari knows one Lightning Bolt, he'll die. At the same time, Kuro is escorting Faith through the jungle. It is the darkened escort.
That is not a friendly escort. More like forcing him to go back to base. But as you were pointing out, Kuro would have loved to have a Janata there. He's level 1:06. So this roaming bounty hunter has really not had the impact that he was hoping for, I think. Maybe this could work. They don't have the damage, I think. Maybe.
With disruption, they can slow him down a little bit.
But this isn't happening.
Yeah, that orb of venom, like, the slow is not enough.
Kraken Shell is just so good against these fairly low damage heroes in the beginning. Both Bounty and Shadow Demon don't hit that hard. And as a result, I think if you look over the supporting cast, it's definitely an advantage for IG experience-wise, but it's made up for by the lead the cores have, simply. As now, well, speaking of cores, Arteezy is going to be a dead core. Who's going to get the kill, though? It's going to go to Ferrari.
Yeah. Faith, though, took a lot of damage in order to make that happen, and they did two hero smoke out with Chuan and Faith. But a successful rotation for IG, where Secret just haven't found the same opening. But most of it is being addressed. Like, Urazor is building into this early, what I'm assuming is going to be a mech.
Yeah, I think so too.
It really should be the mech. And what are you then looking for on Latrak? You got 500, 600 gold for Arteezy. He's got a lot to work with. Tusker, early on, has already managed to find level 6, so he's got a lot to work with.
Arteezy got a Sage's Mask very early here. I guess it's just a Soul Ring build-up into Bloodstone. It's got to be. I was getting excited for a second for maybe something
like
a bit different. Yeah, I was thinking maybe Yule's, or maybe he had another plan with it, but like maybe just a casual Bassy or something. But it's got to be Bloodstone he's planning for.
Yule's maybe not as bad when you look at Ferrari if he was going for a quick Orca, but with a double Null Talisman on Ferrari,
you can
see he's supporting more for like the ultimate. Yeah, these Observer Wards are watching the movement.
Puppy was playing the fake there. He was just standing still, pretending that he didn't know they were coming in, as both teams did have really good vision in this area for this fight to break out. But IG, they get cold feet, they back out. I think it was definitely the right play in that situation as well. And well, I've been focusing a lot on the farm, and Burning has managed to do a pretty good job now. He's actually the same CS as the Lashrak now, after that bottom lane did not go as intended in the beginning. I think IG's game plan is going all right.
Burning, haste rune, walking right underneath that fresh Radiant Observer Ward. So they saw it being picked up, and they're seeing what Burning's up to. He just walks inside the pit to hide from Vision. But S4 is completely alone. Like, they've actually left him to his own devices on the top. Zai is still having a great time. His TP only just came back off cooldown. But it means if IG are going to initiate, they're probably going to be in range of that tier 1 tower of mid. So you'll instantly have both S4 and Zai come to the engagement. And IG are aware of this, so they just start a smoke train. A very unhealthy expedition, but they will be moving up towards the top, trying to find S4. S4 moves around, breaks the smoke, and is right in front of him. He is dead. The plasma field might do a little bit of damage, but he can't even get it off in time. Great gank for IG, and they bring down the Razor. At the same time, Ferrari might be in trouble with Poppy. No, he can't reach him. Trying to get closer to get that disruption off so they can follow up into the straight split earth.
This early game for the Secret supports is just not working out the way they want. Like, I mean, you can look at the gold lead they had, which was almost 1500, and say, well, that looks like a solid early game. But when it's distributed the way it is, you have three cores that are doing well, but the supports are so far behind that how are you going to initiate into a team fight with a Shadow Demon and a Bounty Hunter? How are you going to have a major impact against this extreme Spellburst lineup that IG are running in the mid game? You can just Song into Ravage, and those two heroes are just gone. Like, they don't even get a chance to make a counterplay. So, and this is worrying for Secret, I think, the way this game's going.
You're talking about low net worth Bounty Hunter. He's only 2.5 levels.
I meant experience, but both. Basically both.
Yeah. He's just so far behind. Like, when is this track meant to appear as well? And it's not just for the money, it's for the vision. And the movement speed bonus. Because Razor wants to have that in drove. So does Latrak. So there is no running from them. And we get a whole bunch of Trez now arriving, as well as the Arcane Boots coming in for Latrak.
Well, this could be big for Kuro if he wants to claim this rune. There's no Dire Vision on this right now, so they won't see him taking it. And the absolute biggest play he can make right now is to take that and counter Luo at his stack. If he could manage to kill him in case Luo does get low, he is, however, going to play it safe for now.
And it gives it to
bottling up. Yeah, probably the better choice after all. And, well, if Luo gets this, it's definitely going to be a golden experience advantage all of a sudden for IG as, well, never mind that. Maybe these three double stacks for Secret are going to be enough and going to give Kuro some much-needed experience on this Bounty Hunter as he will split that 50-50 with Arteezy.
And that takes him up to level 4.
Yeah. Solves quite a bit of the problems. He is still not the level he wants to be, but at the least, at the very least, it's not a complete disaster anymore as far as his leveling goes.
All right, so with Zai on this bottom lane, he's gotten quite a large chunk of farm here as the Tusker. What's the best item progression for him? Are we looking for just stats? Are we looking for initiation? What's the go?
I think Glimmer Cape again is really good in this type of game. It's a good counterplay to Song of the Siren into Ravage. You get to save, more or less, keep one hero safe during that combination. It's a very good item against Lina, who will definitely not be getting an Axe this game for the pure damage ult since it's played on Faith on support. Oh, maybe somewhere down the line, but let's be realistic. Not in the first, like, 30 minutes, most likely. And it's a very good item together with Lesh on the same team. It allows him to move in and out of the fights and get his damage out.
Well, he'll have it. I would say he might have a little bit more money if you can find this kill on Luo. He's got support. That's the smoke movement of Arteezy and Puppy, but they actually just come over and look over towards the Dire Ancients, which will no longer spawn. With an Observe Ward planted there, they were able to block it up. So no more easy farming for a Tidehunter to get up to that Blink Dagger he's searching for. At the same time, S4 completes up the mech. So team fight advantage for the moment is going to go the way of Team Secret.
Do you think so?
Even with Song of the Siren, like, I don't think the Naga, well, the Naga currently doesn't anyway have enough mana to do anything. Maybe, oh, yeah, okay. Maybe it'll be a different story when Naga Siren is able to pick up that remaining 800 to get the relic, because he's very close to the Radiance build. And that'll start to chip away at the SD and the Bounty Hunter, who just don't have the stats to survive.
You know, usually at 12 minutes in, when one team has a mech and the other doesn't, I would definitely side with the mech team for teamfights. But it's, once again, the supports are not that strong, and I think if Secret are looking to take a teamfight and win it, they need some really sick snowball plays out of Zai to dodge some of this incoming spell damage that IG will be pumping out. So I'm not sure it's as clear-cut as that. The mech, if nothing else, will maybe disallow IG from making the aggressive teamfight play, but I definitely think they can win the defensive one.
Well, it looks like we're not going to find out anyway, as everyone has basically backed themselves up. There may be an attempt here on the mid, but again, it all comes down to the fact that Puppy has to get the disruption off, but he can't do the combo with S4. He still needs to have Arteezy there to have the split earth, because obviously S4 not having any stuns. But he's going to clean up the Dire camp, so now they can at least start stacking that one again. But the mid push is coming in. 3 points up in that edict. So the damage to the tower will be quite considerable if they can just mop up the wave and attack in. There is fortification available for IG. So Arteezy, yeah, he just goes directly into the edict, at least burns the fortification of IG. And Ferrari hangs around looking for the last deny. He can't get it. So Arteezy will find the hit in the tower. This opens up a little bit more map space, but it's the first tier one tower down in map two.
Perfect timing on the push there. IG were actually looking for a smoke play and they're too late. And Arteezy gets it for free as it looks. It's even going to break here as they won't even find any hero. It got broken by Zai in the river, so really nice here for Secret. Arteezy, he needs to be careful.
Yeah,
Gush
pretty
is
close.
Available. He is probably dead here.
Well, unless there's a snowball that can get in time, which there is not. The sigil was trying to slow up IG's movement. Now with the shards, Faith, Chuan actually able to steal the ice shards instead of taking out the sigil.
And this is going to bring both of IG's supports to level 6. So Secret's supports have almost caught up, or they actually had until that gank on experience. And it's really important for Kuro to get this track now. So even if the fight doesn't go entirely their way, they might still be able to break even with, say, a 3-for-4 trade or something like that on gold. And getting Demonic Purge on Shadow Demon is never a bad thing, although looking over the IG heroes in this game, it's not the greatest compared to if you're picking Shadow Demon into a very mobility-dependent melee core.
Oh, Ravage top lane. It started off with Chuan. S4 down low. Plasma Field being stolen. He needs more time to run away, but the Blink Sonic Wave stream. Perfect from Ferrari. Chuan surviving on 37 HP, but then again, can he? Kuro's right behind him. He's going to track first, kill second. Getting the snipe off while the shards making it so burning and Luo hard to chase. No Song of the Siren being turned on. So the TP successful, snowballing away from Zai. Now his TP out. Are they in range for the Song? No, they're not. They get away with murder, but it's only a revenge murder. But on bottom lane, Arteezy's taking out a tier one tower. It really is just turning into one of these games again, Secret. They're playing so much better across the map. At least in this trade-off. Previously, it was IG rotating better.
Yeah, they've taken three towers and IG haven't claimed any. And I think it's not that big of a concern for IG as long as Burning is farming, which is
Blink
the case.
Dagger on Zai, pull up, and then the instant kill.
He is gone.
That's that Blink Dagger into Walrus Punch. They keep the stuns going. And they even ensured it with a Shuri toss. They want to have every single stun, even if it's just a mini one, to make sure Ferrari can't blink. Speaking of that, hello blink, but Ravage just went on cooldown for 80 seconds.
There's still a good timing window here for Secret to put some pressure. I don't think they're scared of fighting when both Quap is dead and Ravage is down. They also know that Sonic Wave is
there. Blinking, jump in, perfect from Zai, catching Faith, catching Taunt. They're both going to drop to the world. And that means this Tier 2 tower is secure. They might even be able to do damage to the Tier 3. It's a little early, but they do have a fairly fine Lashrak.
This tower is definitely gone.
It's just how much further they go. And they're actually coming back.
There's no way they hold that.
Are they going for... Well, Puppy could. The second TP can't come in time. But yeah, Lua is just going to back himself up. And Arteezy... S4. Secret keep doing this on their course. They pick up one of these big utility items like a mech, and then they go into a hand of Midas before a 20-minute mark. So this time it's over on the Razor.
Now there's four towers claimed by Secret. They're looking to expand their lead even more. Curious to see what way Zai goes. I was considering the Glimmer Cape for him earlier. The Blink Dagger already proved to be a really good choice as he found those two kills in mid. And will he go for the Glimmer now or something entirely different? What does he usually go? He goes for that, he goes for Solar Crest. I think those are his two most picked up items on his utility tusk, so it's probably going to be either of those, or they try to start itemizing more to counter the Naga, but I don't know if there's any item for Tusk that is really good for that, that is not ridiculously expensive. He's going to get an Ogre Club.
Maybe just BKB.
So, yeah, I think that's a BKB build-up, and Secret's game plan this time around will be revolving more around BKBs than last time.
Is there any reason to potentially go in for something like, well, you're already going to Blink Dagger, so you're not going to get Silver Edge.
I don't think the Ferrari bottom. He has blinked already. He is going to get punched as well. The follow-up is enough.
Only just. They kept the stuns going, but the blink, the cooldown was Ferrari's worst enemy.
And the map again being split by Secret. They are really just taking so much control. Look at how even this game was for the first 15 minutes, and just in the last five, Secret have really found a lot on this map. And
their rotations are amazing.
Absolutely.
It's not even just a rotation to find a kill. It's the fact they understand that even if you don't get a kill when they move down a bottom lane, if it happens, it happens. If they force a reaction from IG, then they just make more space. It's smoke and mirrors. We basically dangle a kill on bottom. Maybe we find it, maybe we don't. Doesn't matter, because we're going to take the tier 2 tower on top. Best case scenario, you take kill and you take tower.
Now we need to consider for Secret what the win timing is here. They are of course playing against the Naga. They're playing against the Tidehunter, who later on will probably be able to get a refresher orb if this game goes late. And Queen of Pain has proven to be pretty good in late game situations as well in this tournament and the ones before it. So I'm wondering if Secret are looking to push the base before minute 30, or if they feel confident just keeping on farming up and that Lashrak will be able to deal with Naga later on. S4 at least did go for the Midas on Razor, which is very unusual for him. I think he's one of the core players in the world that pick up this item the very least. He seems to always prefer active items or really high value stats for his money.
Just judging by the items which are coming up from Secret, like buying BTs over on Arteezy this early on, before he goes for anything else after the Bloodstone, I think it actually goes back to what Ben was saying, what Millennium was saying on the panel. The Secret feel like they can counter up everything that this Naga Siren's going to do, so why care about it? Get your BKB so you can deal with both Naga Song as well as the Titan to Ravage, and what other damage is really going to come your way? Probably not much. S4, Bates on the front lines, Chuan, Elisil, Battlefield, Zai, right in the back. Here comes your Ravage from Luo. It's heavily, S4's already down, and joining him is Zai. Not the greatest initiation, and Puppy's on the way back out. Ferrari, great chase, finds Puppy, and it's a double kill for Ferrari.
Really, really good jump in there from Luo, getting that Ravage at the right time, and this could transition into a bottom tier one, maybe,
for
IG.
It can't, because look at top. TZ's pushing in. The second that fight started, he realized it wasn't going to go well. Like, he BT'd himself up.
I think we might be able to hold that with one hero and push bottom with four, but
maybe.
It's a 20-second window. There is a glyph for Secret. And I'm not sure if IG even want to try for it. They might be looking to find Kuro, but I don't think they have the sentries in the right place. They might not even have a sentry at all.
There's a sentry down for Kuro, so he knows he's not being watched, and he's right behind Luo. You have no Ravage on this guy, no Sonic Wave to help him. The Shuri Toss is hurting like hell, and with the catcher potentially purged from Puppy available, moves to the outside of the trees, away from the vision of Ferrari. Luo, TP out, not going to happen. Zai comes in, the Walrus punch, and they will bring down the Tidehunter.
Meanwhile, Arteezy was looking to get the split push going, but IG overrun him as well here with four heroes. So one for one trade. They get the Lesh, who has a Bloodstone, so we'll be respawning faster than the Tide.
They control.
I feel like this is good enough for IG. Even though they're five towers behind, they're still executing the Naga Strat and can make it back in.
I would be worried they can't execute it right now. They committed Song of the Siren to kill off Arteezy. It's down for 83 seconds. You have no Ravage for a minute. Secret have a window of opportunity here where they can push in through bottom. There is fortification available for IG, and they will, in fact, burn it straight away. So it's up to Secret right now. They will take out the remaining outer tower of Invictus Gaming. But if they can find themselves a kill, for example, a lone Rubik or a Ferrari who is getting very, very close to S4, they can just push down and go in. But the window is closing quickly, 35 seconds. And in fact, there it is. Chuan, pick up, throw him down. He steals lightning, but already being punched up to the air, can't get it off. Luo comes in close, but there's very little he can do here. And with no fortification, I think this is high ground time, Sin.
I think that's a bold play, but they might just want to go for it now.
Yep.
I think it's going to get harder in the next 10 minutes, so maybe they feel like this is the best chance they have. 20 seconds on Rubik.
Eight seconds on Ravage. That's the critical timer we're watching.
I think they got to get out of this. This is going to be too hard now.
They've lost their creep wave. The top lane's being pressured by burning. Just back it up and farm up the lanes. And Invictus Gaming, it is really difficult to get in there. And you hit the nail on the head. Like, Secret can look at this thing. It's going to get a lot more difficult to go a high ground later. Controlling the lanes is still fairly easy, primarily just because of the fact Arteezy can get rid of these Naga illusions very quickly and has already the boots of travel, so he can move very freely around the map. But Invictus Gaming's high ground defense is really, really solid. This will not be an easy or a quick game unless IG make a mistake.
Absolutely, but the same could be said the other way. I think it's going to be hard for IG to take full control of this game until Naga gets very big. So they have to play for the late game. I think if IG wins, we're looking at what could be close to an hour or maybe at least 45 minutes before they feel confident pushing the other way. Mm-hmm. And you see, as we talked about, S4 with his Midas buildup looks like that is his plan this time around, is to become big at that point in time. He doesn't feel like they can win the game early enough with items, so he's going to look for some bigger ones later on to fight the Naga.
I'm wondering if this is also one of the rare games we see from a Razor, at least these days. It was more common back in the old days that you go for something like the Aghanim's Refresher Orb. If it's so hard coming up high ground, maybe you require this to take out the racks and take the fight.
It is possible, but that would leave him without BKB, unless we're looking at like a 4 or 5 slot inventory.
Well, that's where the Midas kicks in, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, if he does go for that, that's still going to be 40, 45 minutes. He'll have those items, and then, you know, what does IG have at that point is the question.
Yeah.
This is a close game right now. 4,000 experience and 5,000 gold lead for Secret. It doesn't feel like that tight of a game. And you need to remember, they have claimed 6 towers. So in terms of unclaimed gold, should IG manage to get just these tier 1s and maybe one tier 2, they're evening it out and have then ultimately got more out of the map than Secret with 6 towers and track on their side.
It's actually just checking IG to see if they had Medallion or something along these lines that'll help them bring down Roshan.
Well,
the Medallion gets picked up by, in fact, Kuro on the wrong team for Invictus Gaming. Because they do still have, like, the greatest team to go in and control Roshan. I'm not saying to kill Roshan, just to control him. So maybe they can grab that Aegis Immortal and just slip into the fight. But Arteezy getting so much money, 3,800 with the Voidstone. Zai, well done, that's a tree. That's, in fact, a bushel of trees that you cannot get out of for the moment.
He's probably going to roll down this when S4 finds it for him. No?
No, he's waiting, for the blink dagger.
Yeah, it's probably better. Took too long.
Don't worry, no one saw it.
So,
Puppy with a gem pickup.
Ferrari's actually going to have a hex and 100 gold. So he's going for the build that we saw Fata do yesterday, which isn't really seen very frequently anymore, which is the hex first. on Queen of Pain. It's pretty late, minute 25, but he does have two nulls to boot, and Trezent has, of course, died three times. So, will not be the fastest timing, but still a very impactful item. Going to give them even more potential in their team fights, and a way of initiating where the problem is if they song into Ravage, the BKBs can always be popped by Secret. Mm-hmm. This will allow them to open in a different way and use the song more defensively or as, well, basically force out BKB, then song, then kill the isolated target.
Yep. It was the rework of Naga's song, which is why we mentioned at the very, very start. It reminds us a lot of TI2, but back in those days, you could move the units around that were caught inside the Song of the Sirens. You could use Darkseer Vax, you could use Ravages, and now they cannot be touched until you turn it off. So you have that timing in between it all. And Secret. It's hunt time. So a trip smoke.
How many BKBs do they have? They have one on Arteezy and one on Zai. So none on Razor, who has bought the Ogre Club. So S4 needs to decide now if he wants to buy his Ags or build up for the BKB. Looking for something here. Puppy wants to be the frontliner. Oh. And he finds...
Maybe there's enough. Chuan getting stunned up to start with. Puppy being thrown back, but Chuan already down for the count. The Song of the Siren. Zai could be isolated here because he has the BKB up. The Insnare and Ferrari has the Sonic Wave as well as having that Hex, but not enough life to really stay on the front lines. And now the Yule Scepter up, saving Lina as a self-Yule. Arteezy, the Pulse Nova, carving apart RG's life until the Sonic Wave combo. S4 kept alive by the Glimmer Cave. The Defensive Disruption and Snowball. They can't even find a target to hit. The Snowball up and around. I think he's got lost. His three heroes back under the tier 4 towers to house Secret will basically lay claim to the IG base, the poison for a kill, the tie down as well, and his only Ferrari, the only man alive. He comes back up for the stream, wants Arteezy, claims Arteezy, but he'll lose his life for this one. He's so far out, blink 1 second, and he doesn't have time. Chuan's back to world, the living too. But what a cost to defend. They lose so many. But they did bring down Arteezy, so this push does come to a halt for the moment. But Nadezek can see, he's back up again and can BT the front lines.
That fight was so close. Multiple of Secret's heroes just on 200 health for what seemed to be 10 or 15 seconds in that fight. And
Snowball Disruption.
I think IG might have underestimated how much damage they could actually output with their combo. Luo really didn't want to make a bad Ravage, and it is, of course, a very high-pressure situation. If he goes for a bad Ravage, they could lose the Rex and maybe even almost the game off one big mistake, so wants to play it safe there. They used the song to destroy the Sigil and to counter the BKB of Zai, but it didn't kill him, so ultimately didn't get that much out of the song apart from just those two things. And Secret just had a little bit more in the tank for that fight.
Mm-hmm. You just see what happens, though. Like, when you pop off your combo, and then you pull everyone into the snowball, or Puppy was able to defensively disrupt himself and then jump into the snowball after he did that. Like, that's just so problematic for IG that you throw out your combo, and then you have to have a follow-up after it. For the moment, with Tyler to Ravage down, Secret feel like they can just pop into the pit. And they should be able to quickly kill off Roche, but at the same time, Invictus Gaming, a five-man smoke, primarily for movement speed, so they can get here in time. Burning, Song of the Siren, where are these BKBs? Out comes the Song, Roche out of 2k life, they're coming in. Remember, there's no Ravage, would be a good anchor smash in this area. Ferrari, Sonic Wave still on cooldown too, start to feel Kuro's low, and where is your damage output? Chuan's already gone down, Arteezy turned on the BKB, Burning gets mopped up, Kuro sits inside the pit, they're taking out three, there is just no reaction from IG. They set up, but had no follow-through. Where was the damage meant to come from? Sonic Wave, no Ravage.
I think they just wanted to try to snipe the Roche there, going for a song, and then if Roche is low enough, they could try to steal it. When they were like, it looked like they were doubting themselves, can we kill Roche, can't we? And they start hitting him a little bit, and then they're like, okay, we're not going to be in time, let's try to get the hell out of there. And they're just way too far in, and it's way too late. And I think that is one of those super high-risk plays where you have to look at the risk-reward ratio, and it's really not worth it. Like you said, no Ravage, no Sonic Wave, so the only possible way I can see them winning that fight is if they song perfectly, get the Aegis, and then get some sort of value even out of the Aegis, because
They didn't
have their tools, and now they lose Roche, three heroes, and Arax instead of just a Roche.
Well, if you're going to do that, you should have sent in your illusions to get the vision. Then maybe you would have a little bit more information to work on the timing. Right now, Seeker are taking their advantage forward. The Glimmerkay keeps Arteezy up. Remember, he's got the Aegis and the Immortal to work with, and there's a fresh Desolator over on Zai. The Yule Scepter on Arteezy, that's his new little baby. And Burning trying to battle directly up against him. Arteezy, he's out of mana for the moment. Bloodstone will start to regenerate bit by bit, but he'd like just the Aegis, the Immortal, to pop if he can just soak up a little bit more damage here from Invictus Gaming. In comes Zai with a BKB. He's killed off Luo. He has to buy back. The Ravage is available, but Ferrari blinks away. 100 life. Arteezy's still on the front lines and still is holding on to this Aegis Immortal, not to mention your Scepter. They get through the melee ranks, and Secret don't need to stick around here any longer unless they're searching for kills. The range ranks is a little bit of something, but it's not that much. They can just back it up and wait for IG to come to them.
That's a full lane of racks for them. This is a really big deal. The only thing we really see come out for IG after this fight is going to be the Manta style on Burning, which is something, but it just seems like if they hadn't gone for that Roche fight and maybe just played it defensively and maybe held, they would not have lost their racks yet. Burning would have had the Manta, and it's very unusual, I think, for IG to go for plays like that. They feel so comfortable when they have their Naga, even giving a bit of space away to the enemy, knowing that Burning come mid-late game is so good at splitting the map and getting them back into it, but the pressure might just be getting to
Larry. Be careful.
And now he's in trouble too. Oh my lord, the burst.
The snowball controlled him perfectly. Now Arteezy, he knows exactly what he's up against. Runs in. Yulset are up. The Pulse Nova's doing some work. And Burning, Song of the Siren. He just wants to get out of this one. Actually, he has the TP cancelled. And he is just running himself away. But the Song of the Siren is down. Ravage is still available. And with a fresh blink over on the Rubik, they have some initiation, but at the same time, the same thing came out for Puppy. The Blink Dagger is on the ST.
Secret might be looking for the second lane here. This could be a little bit dangerous. As you said, they have nice. Ravage available. Track is going to be stolen by Chuan. Definitely help them out too, as Arteezy going in really aggressively. He just wants to make sure he uses his Aegis.
His Faith, he's trying to soak up the Laguna Blade if possible, but the snowball down! Rubik just gets crushed until now the Ravage comes in. Ferrari with the Sonic Wave for the SC Disruption. Well, won't keep S4 alive, but Zai lifting himself out of here. He cannot battle on Luo, but Arteezy, he's the man looking for a watch of Aegis, the Immortal timing, as he just keeps pulse serving through him. Now it's gonna pop out. Zai still doesn't want to come back into it, but can Arteezy escape? No BKB charge. Has his own yours after Puppy with a defensive disruption. Gives more Arteezy's up in the air. Luo back down to Earth. Pulse over Lightning. Luo alive. 6 HP drop down to the last attack. It's going to reach it from the strike. Arteezy with a double kill and only one player. Again, it is Ferrari, the last man standing for Invictus Gaming. And soon it's going to be the top racks as the last thing standing inside of Invictus Gaming base. And Kuro's going in for more. The track's on Ferrari. The blink down. The Yule Scepter already onto the track, but a walrus punch. They find Chuan. Maybe this is it. Ferrari's down for the count. You have the leaner, but disruption's already happening. Arteezy has no stun. He evades, though he doesn't display. Down to 69 life, and that's GG. Secret will be facing evil geniuses in the grand final of ESL1 Frankfurt.
Once again, they simply... I don't know, they just outplayed them again. Absolutely. Phenomenal performance from Team Secret once again. IG, as mentioned, had one or two questionable decisions that really cost them. But at the end of the day, when you look at